Thanks everyone for being here. I'll stay as long as you guys have questions. I'm going to do my best to answer it all. Just want to start real quick with a couple things. I want to thank our fans for their tremendous support all year. We're very disappointed that we weren't able to deliver October baseball, something I feel the fans deserve year in, year out. That feeling of letting our fans down should motivate all of us, every single one of us in this organization. I know it does for me to put the work in necessary to build the next Cubs championship team. I want to thank Joe. I know not everyone in this room is in St. Louis, so I want to just take a minute to thank him for everything that he did for this organization and celebrate him as the best commander in Cubs history. Really a remarkable 5-year run. We could not have asked for more. 4 trips to the playoffs, 3 CSs, World Championship, a legacy that'll live on forever. And I couldn't have asked for a better partner. Incredibly loyal and supportive. I learned a ton from him every step of the way and changed the franchise forever. So I want to recognize him for the legend that he is and wish him all the best. I'm excited to see what his future holds on the field. Quick note, you know, look, when they fail to make the playoffs, especially with the second highest air hall in baseball, that is not something that is on the manager. That is not something, especially that is on ownership. When we fail to accomplish any of our goals, that is the responsibility, that is my responsibility as the leader of the baseball operation. So as a leader, it's really important to be accountable. And it's really important to take a really honest look at things that we can do better, things that I can do better. And that's something that we've been doing, something that we'll continue to do. Be honest with ourselves and find areas that we can improve and then execute and improve in those areas. So you are likely to see change in this organization. Opportunity when you fall short of your goals and fail to perform in the biggest moments as dramatically as we did, it provides a real opportunity if you're willing to be honest with yourself and willing to take a hard look inside. And so there's going to be an opportunity for change. I think it's going to be, we're not blowing anything up per se, that's not the goal, but we're likely to see real change, real adjustments at various levels, most levels of our baseball operation in some form or another. Obviously, the manager, the player group, there's going to be some change, some real change in our player group. Our player personnel processes, that's something that we've already started taking that. With our R&D department, I think they do a fantastic job. Innovation built out, I think we can utilize them a little bit better in certain areas, help them impact making the team decision. Scouting and player development a little bit more. Scouting and player development, a couple of departments that we started to build up 8 years ago. And we've been making adjustments as we go and try to modernize, but I think this is a good opportunity to take a look and how would we set it up if we were building it from scratch? How would we set it up not to adjust for the modern game, but to be centered around the modern game? We had already made some structural leadership changes, and we'll continue to make more adjustments as well. You're likely to see the director of hitting and the director of pitching join the organization to ensure that we are building these departments, teaching the game, evaluating players for where the game is now and where the game will be going. Make sure we continue to be at the cutting edge. So there will be some changes. It's our responsibility as leadership to take a look at everything that I personally can do better, and we can do better as an organization because we are extremely energized and optimistic about our future. It's incumbent on us to build the next Cubs championship team, but to continue to serve this press conference as well. Take all your questions.
Theo, is there going to be a change in philosophy at home to take up the roster of being more potential athleticism, speed, throughout, or at least a little bit more?
The goal is to have it all, recognizing that you can never have it all. You have to be able to make some sacrifices. Every episode of your roster in the game is flawed. You have to playoffs, some fashion, something we weren't able to do this year. So we want to score as many runs as we can. We want to prevent as many runs as we can. And controlling the strike zones is a huge part of that on both sides of the ball. But yeah, athleticism is extremely important. It shows up in all facets of the game. And that's an area where we certainly can improve. I think the key is, you know, if you try to build a team around athleticism, we often end up struggling to win that battle. The strike zone ends up costing you. So we want to be more athletic, be more baseball athletic, more baseball smart, but continue to build teams that can do a great job dominating the strike zone, scoring as many runs as possible.
Well, what are the characteristics of the next manager that you would like to run the Chicago Cubs, adding on to all the great things that Joe has already brought?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's important when I answer any question about what we're looking for in a manager to recognize that Joe, the Hall of Fame manager, his methods worked here for 5 years, are proven to work. So please don't take anything I say as far as what we're looking for at a manager at this moment in time, he was the perfect guy for this team at the perfect time. This is about looking forward now for the group that we're likely to have at this moment in time. We're looking forward. What are different areas of emphasis that are important for this group at this time? And I don't want to answer it too specifically. I know it's a cop-out, but if I get into a long list of specifics and every managerial candidate that we come in is just going to list every single specific that we said, I think I think we struggled as an organization this year to make sure that with the Major League team, the whole was as good or better than the sum of the parts. And we had a lot of good individual performances. We had a lot of talent and ability. I think if we do our job the right way, we're going to have a lot of talent next year. We're going to score a lot of runs. We're going to prevent a lot of runs. And the next manager has to create an environment that turns that into wins. And that's not solely on the manager at all. It's roster construction and everything else. But that's what we're looking for in a manager, is to try to help our group. Any team is looking for that manager. Come together and make sure the whole is as good or exceeds the sum of the parts. And the next manager will be a success if he can find a way to get the most out of each player. That's an obvious goal, but we want to make sure that with the players that we have, we're reaching them, we're developing them, we're providing an environment where they can continue to grow and thrive. If we have players that are going to be successful Major League players, we have to find a way to make it here. That's very important. It's an organization-wide challenge, not just on the manager, but yes, the next manager is going to be important. His responsibility. Cultivating a winning culture behind the scenes. We've obviously had a winning culture. Joe did an unbelievable job of creating that. Again, at this moment in time, we have to perform for certain areas of emphasis that will reach this group and help us meet our current challenges, not the challenges that we've had over the last 5 years. So picking priorities and values and emphasize work, I think, is going to be really important. This group at this time, we need to find a way to create a culture and environment that compels every player to push himself to be the absolute best version of himself, to be the very absolute best player that he can be. It's a culture where that's accepted, or expected rather. If a player joins our culture, he's lifted up by the culture in terms of the amount of work, the habits, leaving no stone unturned to be the best. I think it's important that Joe, again, was wonderful at this, but it's going to be important for the next manager of this particular group. And it's time to find a way to foster a team identity. I think this group, our routines tend to be more individualized. There wasn't a lot of work as a team. And I think it's going to be important for this group that we find time to work as a team, that we find time to assemble as a team, that we find ways to deliver messages to the team so that there can be a greater sense of team identity and purpose for this group. I think that's something that we need. At this moment in time with this group, I think accountability is important. We're pretty mistake prone this year. This is, again, organization by challenge, not on the manager, but the next manager should be part of this. is helping create a culture of accountability, where there's just a sense that, you know, sloppy mistakes, mental mistakes aren't tolerated, and so there's an expected level of focus that we all work together to establish that mitigates the amount of mistakes like that that are made. And in a sense of grind, you know, grinding from the first pitch of the season through the end, and the last couple of Septembers, we, I feel like, and this is, again, it's on me and on our group, but I feel like our team sometimes would be expected to just get it done in September, in the second half, as we always have, but last two Septembers have proven that you can't take that approach. You have to find a way to grind from the beginning. It's a challenge. And certainly some years we're better than others. It's not something that falls solely on the manager, but that, I think that's a good challenge for the next manager of this group going forward. So those are a lot of attributes. I'd be happy to answer more specific questions about it if you want to.
Regardless of who the manager is, do you see the front office taking more of an active role in of what goes on the field in terms of the lineup, bullpen usage?
No, I don't. I think just about every organization right now is sort of a combination of the front office has to collect the talent, choose the players, assemble the roster, and if they're smart, they do so. A lot of veterans manager, and you ask the manager and the coaching staff to deploy those assets and put them in a position to succeed and win games. You're smart, he probably has to make good use of a lot of the brain power that's in the R&D department, in the front office, and the scouts, and everyone to be able to try to help make good decisions and show certainty with that. I think that kind of balance is what we're looking for going forward. But we're not looking to be any more hands-on at all, especially as far as, you know, getting up messaging or inspiring the team. That's something that I also have a soft factor that I definitely want to lead to the next manager, the message.
David,
I don't know. We're quick to get working on our list. We haven't called to ask for permission on anybody, but I think we're full speed ahead. We're not going to drag this out any longer than it needs to be, but we also want to be thorough. Make sure we. It's difficult, you know, the interview process. You want to make sure you don't end up with the candidate who interviews the best. You want to end up with the candidate who's going to be the best manager.
Yeah, there was one ex-player who sounded like he's very interested in sets on national TV last night. Can a player who played with some of these guys now be a viable candidate to manage them?
Yeah, I mean, you're talking about David Ross.
I am.
Might as well, to be honest, and ask the question directly. I think, you know, David Ross is has a lot of great things going for him. I would say his connection to the players on the team, and especially his connection to the 2016 team, are not necessarily assets those are not necessarily things that are going to be important to us. I think Rossi is a really attractive candidate. He's going to be evaluated on the merits. What he can bring to the table as a major league manager, given his skills, given his experiences, given his all those things, just as every other managerial candidate can evaluate it. But we're looking forward, we're not looking backwards. I think in some ways there's been almost too much emphasis on 2016 and looking back. And so his connection to that team, or even to some of our existing players, will not be a significant part of the
situation. Is it also not
just the players to handle the right? Something you have to consider, but I'm just saying that what we're looking for is someone who's a great manager for the Cubs moving forward, not necessarily, certainly not looking backwards, and not with undue emphasis on a couple of players and personal connections, but that's not a major factor.
Are you acknowledging that he's a candidate?
Yeah. I'm sorry?
Yeah, he's a candidate.
He's on our broad list of candidates. I figured I was going to get that question. He addressed last night on TV.
So he's
one of many candidates.
Is lack of experience managerial coaching a potential red flag?
Lack of experience is, and I'm speaking broadly for the group, so lack of experience is always a factor. You know, it's not a determining factor, but it's a significant factor. And, you know, I always have greater comfort level hiring for roles for which the person's done the role before. especially with the new manager, but I think there are ways for that to be overcome. There are a lot of different ways to get experience in this game. Beliefs, skills, personal attributes, those can outweigh a lot of experience, but experience certainly helps.
Theo, you mentioned accountability for a lot of things. Isn't that usually from a player in the clubhouse that can handle that? Do you have that guy, and would you look to acquire?
Everything I listed as far as what will help make the next manager success, or needs real contributions from the entire organization, front office, including the player group. And yes, creating a winning culture that includes an emphasis on accountability. That it's important to have players create that, and we do. I think, you know, and it's impossible to paint our entire player group with a broad brush, right? But you can't say the players were X, Y, or Z and haven't applied all 25 players. We have leaders in that clubhouse, we have players who are accountable. I think if you talk to the players and they're honest about what was there enough accountability, just leaving aside the manager, leaving just the 25 guys holding each other accountable for mistakes and holding each other accountable for certain standards, I'd say it's an area we can need to improve. We can do better. So that needs to come from inside the clubhouse. I think needs a strong voice from the manager and some more from the front office as well.
Did you say similar last year? Wasn't that part of the off-season conversations with some of the leaders?
Yeah, I think a lot of the issues that we have now were started to show themselves from the last year.
So will you look to acquire guys like that? Maybe bring that along?
Yeah, always. We actually we got good contributions in that area from Daniel DeSalso this past year. We had a really difficult year on the field.
Is it disappointing though, Theo, that you are somewhat highlighting the same issues for a second straight year?
Yeah. It is.
And how do you explain how things didn't change?
I think it just reveals that some real changes needed to repair. I think, you know, a lot of these issues started to come to the fore a little bit towards the end of last year. And we also had a group that's accomplished great things. And made the playoffs four straight years, we won 95 games. And so we were, if you want to say we were stubborn with this group, I think that's fair. We had real belief in this group. And, I think there's, again, to be self-critical and honest and accountable, I think there can be a bit of a winner's trap dynamic sometimes where when you've had great success and won in that group at the time, they had won more games than anyone else in baseball over those 4 years. You look at the methods, the players, everything that had gone on, and you attribute the success to them rightfully, but it can lead to attributing too many good qualities or placing too much faith in that. And I think it requires real leadership to move beyond that. That's an area where I need to do a better job as a leader, letting go of the past and focusing on the future. This is clearly a moment of transition where I just listed all the different areas where we're going to have change and where we're going to build something anew. Again, I think there are a lot of players from this group, players on the team right now, that are going to be part of the next championship Cubs team. But we're going to build something anew. And I think there were real efforts made last offseason, real unconventional methods I never want to have to do again, to be honest with you, to try to reach guys. And they were coming from the players as well. The players identified areas of concern, areas where we needed to try to do things differently. And there was good, healthy conversation about that. The vast majority of it remained confidential behind the scenes. And I think there was good intentions and good effort, but in the end, that kind of change is really difficult, especially with tremendous continuity. I think that's one of the reasons we're embracing a lot of change.
A couple of questions on assumptions here. I assume you're not going to be going over the luxury tax coming next year. Again, it's an assumption. I don't know if that's right or wrong. can I assume that there are going to be some either well-known, popular players that are going to be forced to be moved by virtue of salary?
No, I think with regards to payroll, I wouldn't make any assumptions because we are, I think we've come to realize that strategically it's best just not to talk about it. I don't want to, first of all, there's a lot of unknowns going forward when it comes to what is and what is not available to us, say, in the trade market, for example. So I can't sit here and speak definitively about what you can expect or what you can assume. And then it's also, I don't think it's wise to tip your hand to the rest of the industry where your payroll is likely to end up or how you're going to treat the competitive balance threshold. That said, I think it's important to note we have the second highest payroll in baseball this year. Some are sort of pointing fingers of blame at ownership and at Tom, and because of that, I think it's important to note that we've had a top six payroll every year, with the second highest payroll in baseball this year. We get everything that we need from ownership. We'll continue to get everything we need from ownership. When a significant amount of money opened up in season this year, with Ben Zobrist's departure, instead of pocketing that money, they allowed us to pour it right back into the team, something they've consistently done. Revenues that we're going to allow to pour right back into the team. We signed Craig Kimbrell, which, while it didn't work out for this year, was clearly the best use of those dollars to attempt to solve a weakness on a very good team in season. It was a unique opportunity in season when they allowed us to spend those dollars. At the trade deadline, going over budget again for Nick Castellanos, was such an impactful player trying to get us into October. And everything they've done for Wrigley Field on top of the money they've given us to spend in baseball operations. So I think you could argue that there's not an ownership group in baseball that's put more into the team and the ballpark over this last year or so than the Rickets have. So it's not on them. But as far as your assumptions, I think you can assume we're going to have really supportive ownership for the reasons I just outlined. And you can assume that we're going to do everything we can to build a sustained winner in 2012.
You mentioned Joe Madden. The offense since 16 has been one of the most mind-boggling things to figure out for you in years in baseball. I mean, Joe kept talking about the runs going to be in the offense. Then you look at the names 2 through 8 at least. It's a pretty darn good name.
Yeah, it is. I mean, I think if you go around the diamond, I mean, we had a lot of outstanding individual performances. Contreras had a great year. Caratini had a really good year. Played Chris Bryant had a bounce back year. Javi Baez had another outstanding season. Rizzo had an amazing year. Obviously, had some issues at second base. So, spent classes late. Left field Schwarber had a breakthrough season, especially in the second half, performed at an extremely high level. JAA had a productive year. And then right field Castellanos, I know this last third of the season was a revelation in the right field. So, you're right, probably should that add up to more than the fifth most runs in the league? Yeah, maybe it should, but it did. I think in the past it's been easy to look at our performance with runners in scoring position, high leverage offensive performance. That was actually better this year in a lot of areas. We're certainly losing the contact battle. We make these contact at any point in baseball. And despite those great offensive individual seasons, I think we're still, we're still a team that can be game planned for, and we see the fewest fastballs in baseball, and that's an adjustment that you'd like to think we've made by now, but we haven't, so we have to own that and continue to try to improve in that area. And then the base running, which are the most outs on the bases in all baseball, that kind of seems different too, why some of the components don't add up to being on the top 2 or 3 run score. We're third in, we're the third lowest ERA in the league, the fifth most run scored. So in a lot of ways our pitching outperformed our hitting, a lot of the emphasis on the pitching. And certainly we get into the pitching, our high leverage pitching, certainly was not satisfying.
Is the answer to find guys that can hit spin better and make it a little bit more complete?
The more well-rounded hitters you have, the better. I think it's continued growth from certain players, and focus on their areas of weakness. And then, you know, we've made some transactions. Castellanos was one, for guys who cover parts of the strike zone around the last one or two, and trying some hitters for whatever the game.
As far as the player development goes, though, have you guys come up with any production as far as bringing players up too early, or just be a theory about getting at least 1,500 at bats if you're a position player in the minor leagues, and go figure out why guys have come up here and done well and on back ends in some cases?
I think we're constantly evaluating that. It's all based on the individual. Nico Horner is a good example. We don't ever draw it up that a player's going to skip AAA. It's not determined yet where Nico's going to start next season, but given his mental makeup, given his skill set, maybe as a person, we felt that was something under the extraordinary circumstances that he could handle. I think it's important that player development continues at the major league level. These days, it's becoming a younger player's game. If you look around baseball, the best teams and young players dominating. Yes, it's not linear. There's going to be regression at the major league level, but our players have had some real regression. It's taken a while for them to dig out from. So that's something that we have to solve. But I think the answer is, pushing forward with player development, finding ways to really finish development off as best you can in the minor leagues, but understanding too that you need to create an environment at the major league level where players who are expected to perform night and night are still developing. Still working on their weaknesses, still making adjustments to the league, and that's an area I think we need to do better.
That said, you think you might have to change philosophy of the type of coach that is at the major league level rather than an experienced coach who has dealt with major league or somebody that actually helped continue to player development?
No, I don't want to blame anything coaching staff. We've tried a variety of coaches, as over the last couple of years, and they've all had their own skill sets and ways to reach the player. So we'll continue to try to build the single best coaching staff that we can. And there's a lot of talent in that coaching room. I just think, I think we need to go in with the expectation that the player's development is not finished, because it's not going to be. Young players do not get fully developed in the minor league. So finding coaches that can reach young players and win at the same time is a challenge. But we have a lot of good coaches here, and we'll continue to try and build the best in that possible.
Speaking of young development, how disappointing has it been that you haven't been able to develop your own young pitchers, and how much is it that an emphasis?
Shortcoming in the organization overall over the last 8 years, it's something that we need to address. I mean, to put it into context, or to offer a brief counterpoint, although it doesn't mitigate the impact of this at all. Our goal has always been to find good major league pitching. We want to pitch well at the major league level. Part of our broader strategy when we got here was to build through young position players, acquire young position player amateur talent, develop it, and develop a core of those position players that could thrive at the major league level, and then build a great pitching infrastructure that they would be able to take major league pitching that we acquire through trades, or through free agency, or through other means, and win with that pitching. It was the overall strategy. Not saying we weren't trying to develop pitching, we had, but that was the broader strategy. And in our 5-year window, we've been competitive. So from 2015 on, we have the second lowest ERA in all of baseball. 30 teams have the second best ERA. So we've accomplished that part of the goal. We've had really good major league pitching. But there is a cost to pay when you don't develop your own pitching. It's certainly been a disappointment, and it's put us in a position to have to be overly aggressive in trades and free agency to maintain that level of having elite starting pitching. So we've had good pitching. For that to continue, we need to start developing our own. And we've made a lot of adjustments the last couple of years. We're starting to see some of the impact of that. The major league bullpen this year, some players coming through our system, some players acquiring really small trades that we have some specific development ideas about. Our development staff and our R&D guys did a great job using old techniques and cutting-edge technology to help these players make adjustments and thrive, and in some cases dominate the major league level. We need a lot more of that. You're going to you're going to see your
it turned back on.
That's not all. As I said, you're going to see some restructuring in the patient department where we attempt to keep the impact guys we have in a position to succeed and also bring in some outside voices or some new voices to make sure we're cutting edge.
Any medical procedures such as like Starvish and Morrow had last week to pass a cleanup of some sort?
No, we don't expect him to require any surgery at all. He's really determined to have a great off-season and looking forward to a full legitimate spring training. He feels awful about the way this year went. Recognize he was in an unusual position, but you're going to see a really determined individual next year to benefit from a full spring training.
Following up on Bruce's question, how about Bryant and Baez? Are they going to be surgery free this off-season?
Yeah, that's our belief right now. We have a full medical meeting about a week, so if anything changes, I'll let you know. I don't believe we have any surgeries.
Yeah, we want that to the offense side. How do you plan on addressing the leadoff spot?
That's an area where we can clearly do a lot better. I mean, those are unacceptable numbers that we got out of leadoff this year. So I think there are a couple different ways to go. If we can acquire a prototypical leadoff hitter, that'd be fantastic and make everybody's life easier going forward. If we can't, the best solution is just get as many players to get on base as possible. And a lot of different options of guys you can throw out based on matchup situations into that spot. I think we have to do a better job of having more diverse offensive skill sets, so that including players who specialize in getting on base, and they can be a great base runner, all the better. So that's the lowest possible hanging fruit that there is. If you look at our performance this year, that has to get better as well.
Hey, as you're thinking about the ball, in just the sense that literally everyone that went out there kind of team, is it kind of like the ninth inning for a leader? It is different.
There were certainly guys who affected their performance.
I'm just curious, I've always
felt could get one guy to hold the position. That was a huge asset for a team. But that if you have to do that at the expense of having a hitter who just drives the ball, knocks some runs, and gets on base and slugs, and therefore you're not comfortable putting the outside, it's not worth it. You have to put as many outstanding offensive players as possible. And as a rule, the teams I've built have always placed a huge priority of getting on base. And so we've always had, usually had, lots of options. So if you set out as a goal to lead the league on base percentage, you're usually not going to be wanting the leadoff spot. So I'd rather keep that goal, one through eight, find guys who get on base and should take care of himself. But the best outcome by far is to get someone who's comfortable in that spot, thrives in that spot, and that spot provides energy and so takes the onus off everybody else. But that's always been the case. We just haven't always been able to do that.
You talked about Joe Maddon being a Hall of Fame manager, so obviously it comes with huge shoes to fill, and if you're going to replace him, the expectation is the next guy's got to do better than that. How do you manage those expectations? Is that something that you look for, maybe in a new manager, somebody who can deal with the pressure of replacing that?
Yeah, I think if we find the right person, he's not going to be concerned about filling Joe's shoes or living up to expectations on an individual basis. He's going to be focused on making this the best organization, the best major league team can be, having sustained success at the big league level, maximizing each year's chances. So for next year, the 2020 Cubs chances, get to October and play good October baseball. So I think there's, what I've seen managers, when they take over, when they join a new organization, there's so much going on. There's 25 relationships to build just on 25-man roster. You got probably another 30, 40 relationships of players who are going to impact the big league team in one way or another. You've got your entire coaching staff, entire front office, ownership, media, fans. You have to develop systems for run production, run prevention, communication, how things are going to work. It's triggered from a fire hose. So I don't think there's going to be much thought about having Phil Jones' footsteps, except I think the right manager will ask a lot of questions about what Joe did to make him so successful. What's not broken that doesn't need fixing, and then what areas there are where he can make his own mark and
that Larray play?
Yeah, you know, our coaching staff, we're going to meet with them tomorrow, so I don't want to get into specifics, but I'll say, you know, we do, as we start to assemble our original list here, I'm interested in talking to the candidate.
Anybody else in house?
I mentioned Rossi specifically. I haven't talked to our coaching staff yet, so I'll get back to you late tomorrow. I want to talk to this guy specifically as far as.
Are you open to taking perhaps a short step back to make three steps forward if that impacts 2020?
We have a lot of good players, and we have high standards, and we absolutely want to win a World Series next year. We want to keep making the playoffs as often as possible. You know, 4 out of 4 years felt a lot better than 4 out of 5. Whenever you don't make it, it's horrible around here. That's not something want to experience again. Next year is a priority. We have to balance it with the future, and probably that's more important now than it was even a year ago, because we're now just 2 years away from a lot of our best players reaching their end of their period of club control with the Cubs. So I think the goal is to do everything we can to win the World Series next year. We also have to pay attention to the long term and maximize this window while also putting in a lot of good work to open a new one as well. So there are a lot of examples of teams that go right up to the very end of their contention window with their players, and then all of a sudden face a long term painful rebuild, and that's not something we're interested in. We don't want to put our fans through that type of long process. So the art of it will be to do everything we can to maximize all the talented players that we have now, and also sure we're in a really good position for the long term.
I know we're always told there's no such thing as an untouchable player. Mm-hmm. But even a year ago, there were big headline rumors on TV. Is he in play? I mean, are we to the point where everybody, even at his level, is in play?
Yeah, I'm not gonna say anything about specific players other than to say I don't believe in untouchables, and never have. I just think there are obviously players who are really hard to move, and you're just doing the organization.